Okay. Anybody still needs a minute to submit the quiz? I heard somebody say they were saving it. Did you get it submitted?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go over it while you're still thinking about your answers. A sample, that word was important. Of 42 employees in a company is selected. The average age is found to be 35 years. Is 35 a parameter or a statistic? It is a statistic. Very good. A sample of 47 employees in a company is selected and asks his or her salary. It is quantitative because it's measuring money. The amount of water an elephant drinks per day is measured in ounces. Is this study observational or experimental?
Observational.
Very good. A rock is thrown across a pond and the distance is recorded. This data is continuous. Because you had to use a measuring tool to measure it. You had to have something to measure that with. Discrete means you could count it with no tools. Discrete is counts, continuous is measurements. Questionnaire is given in which students rank their professors on a scale from 1 to 10, with 1 being not satisfied and 10 being extremely satisfied. What is the highest level of measurement for this data? That's right, because even though it's numbers, they do not measure anything numerical. It's actually qualities. Temperatures of 8 different cups of coffee are recorded. What's the highest level of measurement for that data? Say again? Okay, a cup of coffee that is 25 degrees is half as hot. No. So it is not ratio level. It is not ratio level.
Interval.
It is interval level. Differences make sense. A difference of 25 degrees, a difference of 10 degrees, a difference of 2 degrees. But 16 degrees is not half as warm as 32 degrees and so forth. The ratios do not make sense for years. So time is one thing that's always interval level, and temperature is always interval level. Remember that. Temperature and time is always interval level. Now, if you're talking about the amount of time, not time itself, like 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, that is ratio level. But if you're talking about time as in dates or days, that are days of the week or something like that. No, that's not. You have to be careful with time. The heights of several trees are measured, and recorded. What's the highest level of measurement? Ratio, because one tree can be twice as tall as another one or half as tall as another one. Sample consists of every 6th person in a line that contains 750 people. What sampling technique was used?
Systematic.
Good. Researcher divides a new subdivision into 15 plots of land. A soil sample is taken from each plot. Which sampling technique was used? Good. 5 Northeast State Math 1530 sections are randomly selected and each student was asked to complete a survey. What sampling technique was used?
Cluster.
So how is these lines worth a point?
They're 1 point each. So you can achieve a score of 9 or 10 or 8. Okay? Okay, let's go to class. Go to nearpod.com. I have handouts for you. We're going to talk about chapter 3. I do have the class roll, but I have not passed it around yet. The letters H, X, A, F, Y. Is everybody in? Nearpod.com, the lesson pin is H, X, A, F, Y. And you can log in from your computer, your iPad, your smartphone, whatever you want to use. Everybody should be able to get here. Try them right now. Is it not loading it? That or you can go to Northeast Texas Wireless, whichever. Just put your username and passport there.
comes back to me occasionally, and it'll take it and drop it. Okay, is your... Is everybody getting in? Okay, you can tell that it's done and go back to your apartment and see if it's more. There you go. And then when the yellow box is where the top of your PIN X, HX, AFY. No, that's, there'll be a different one every time we use a question. Anybody else have a problem getting in? Okay, we're going to start chapter three. Up to this point, the most arithmetic type work or mathematical work we have done is we've had to be able to rank order things and count. We haven't needed to be able to do any other math other than add, subtract, and maybe divide, but mostly it's been count. Now we're actually going to go into something where we're going to need to do some formulas. We are going to do some formulas tonight, but only a few. And the formula for the mean, I will go with you, go through it with you by hand on the first few problems, but then I'm going to graduate using the calculator really quick. We will do a standard deviation problem by hand one time, just so that you'll have some idea of what it is that it's measuring. But we are not going to calculate standard deviation by hand. The calculator is going to do all of our work for us. Okay? So chapter three is about statistics, finally, the numerical type of statistics that we use to describe, explore, and compare data sets. We're going to look at five different kinds of statistics. The first one is going to be called measures of center, or some textbooks call it measures of central tendency. The second one will be measures of variation, and the variation is how things are different from each other, even though they belong to the same data set. And then measures of relative standing and box plots. Box plot is actually a return to graphical, but it's based on something numerical. This is just notation. Don't worry about writing all of this down for the time being, because actually we're going to be using the notation and you'll be able to figure out what it means as we start using it. But pronunciation wise, X bar is a lowercase x with a line over, and it actually represents the mean of a set of sample data values. Not population, only sample. Okay? The way that you find the mean, you have found one forever. I know all of you have. You called it an average. You average your grades. You add up your grades and divide by how many grades you had. Okay? That's what this formula says that you're going to do. Find a sample mean, you add up the X's, the grades, and then you divide by the number of grades, which is lowercase n. The reason we use the lowercase n is because the population uses uppercase n because it's the big group, and the sample is a little piece of the big group. So notice that when we do this, the formula down here for the population, the process is exactly the same. We add up all the values in the population and divide by how many were in the population. But we use a different symbol. It's a Greek symbol that looks like a U, but it's actually a Greek lowercase m. And that m stands for mean, and it's pronounced mu. So the way you would write it is basically it's a U with a long tail in the front of it. We're going to talk about descriptive statistics. The word descriptive tells you that you're going to describe something. So their purpose is to summarize or describe some characteristic of a known set of data. Inferential statistics will come about later on in chapter 7, 8, 9, and 10.
What we're going to learn in chapter 3 is about how to describe, and then we'll have to apply those descriptions to a population and try to come to a conclusion. So it's the part where you're coming to conclusion that's inferential. In between chapter 3 and chapter 7, we'll have to talk a little bit about probability and probability distributions. I will make that as short and as painless as I can, because that's the part most people really can get confused at, and that's primarily because we tend to overthink it. So I'll try to keep it simple for you. So let's talk first about measures of center. Bless you. The value at the center or the middle of a data set is the formal definition, but I like one-word definitions myself. I like the word typical. It's the measure of a typical member of the data set, one that you would expect to see. In fact, later on, we'll refer to the measure of center as being the expectation, because it's what you expect to see. All of these four words are measures of center, or measures of average. The mean is actually called the arithmetic mean, and it's the only one actually out of the whole bunch that you really have to do much arithmetic to get. The mean is where you add everything up and then divide by how many you've added up. The median is the middle. Think about that thing between the four-lane highway. That's the median. It's in the middle of the highway. The mode is the thing that shows up the most often. And then we'll talk about what the mid-range is as we get to it. So first we'll talk a little more about the mean. The arithmetic mean, which we'll always just call the mean, is the measure of center that is obtained by adding the values and dividing by the total number of values, and it's what most people call an average. But if you read any kind of statistics in the newspaper and they say the average citizen of Nashville makes XYZ dollars, I really doubt that they're telling you the true average. They're probably not the average that you think of. They're probably reporting to you the mean income for people in Nashville, because they're not going to take into account how many really high wage earners there are living in Nashville and how many really low earning people there are in Nashville that are very poor. So they're actually referring to the median as the average. Our notation here, just so that everybody's clear, X is the variable. It's the value of the pieces of data. N is the number of data values in a sample, and capital N is the number of data values in a population. The advantage of the mean is that it is relatively reliable. Means of samples drawn from the same population don't really vary as much as the other measures of center. And the mean actually takes every single data value into account, because you add up every single one of them. But that also makes it have the greatest disadvantage. It is sensitive to every data value. It is not a resistant measure of center. Resistant means that it tends to have the right value most of the time. It's an unbiased estimator. As an example, suppose that I were to take a random sample of 10 from some company of 10 employees, and I collect the information about their salaries. So the 10 employees that I have from this company, I have a part-time custodian, I have a receptionist, I have an office manager, I have some sales reps, maybe about 4 or 5, and then I have the CEO, the head honcho, the big guy. Now the part-time custodian probably makes maybe $10,000-$15,000 a year. Office manager, maybe $25,000, $30,000 a year. Sales reps, maybe $40,000, $50,000, maybe. What do you think CEO makes? Six figures minimum, okay? So if I add his six-figure salary in with all these other five-figure salaries, what happens to the mean? It's skewed. It pulls the mean up toward his salary. And in fact, what will happen in most cases is that the CEO's salary will pull the mean up so high that all of the other salaries fall below that. And that's certainly not typical. So you wouldn't want to use the mean in that case. You would be better off using the median salary, which is probably maybe one of the sales reps. It'll still be a little high, but it'll be a lot more typical of what the people at that company actually make. The median is the middle value when the original data values are arranged in order of increasing or decreasing magnitude. You do have to rank order your values first, and then you find the one in the middle. The advantage is that it's not affected by the extreme values. The CEO wouldn't have anything to do whatsoever with the median value from the company I just talked about. And really and truly, the custodian wouldn't either, because they're on the extremes. So the advantage to the median is it's what we call a very resistant measure of center. The mode is the value that occurs with the greatest frequencies. And data sets can have one mode, more than one mode, or no mode at all. Bimodal simply means that they have two data values in a data set and they're both showing up with the same frequency or pretty close to the same frequency. Multimodal means there's more than two data sets that are two data values that occur with the same frequency. And if you have more than two modes, chances are the modes are not going to be very informative. Unless they're all close together, then they might. No mode means there's no data value that's repeated. Everything is showing up once. The interesting thing about the mode is it's the only measure of center that can be used with nominal level data. It's the only one. And that's because it's based on count. So let's look at some examples here. In example one, we have 1.10 showing up twice. Therefore, it's the mode. Everything else is in there once. The mode is 1.10 because it's in there two times. In example two, we have two modes, 27, which we have three of, and 55, which we have three of. And in example three, we have no mode because there are no repeats. And those of you that are trying to take notes, probably you want to hold off on that. You can view the recording afterward. It'll be easier to take notes than it will be to try to take them out because you don't have any. Usually if I give you notes, part of it's already written down. But this part of it you're going to have access to after class to be able to go back and fill in anything that you feel like you need to. Yes?
You said the other example of the second example was bimodal.
What's the third one that repeats?
The 88.
It only repeats twice. The others are repeating three times, so they beat it.
So twice, so it repeats twice, that doesn't count? Or
does it's not that it doesn't count, it's just that these repeat even more times than the 88 does.
Okay.
Okay, it's not just that it appears multiple times, but it has the highest count.
Okay.
Okay, so 27 and 55 have the highest counts. Now, this one, I'm going to be honest with you up front. It's not used very much, and you're going to quickly see why it's not used. The mid-range is the value midway between the maximum and the minimum values. It only looks at two numbers out of your data set, the littlest one and the biggest one. Now, if your data set's still relatively evenly distributed, it might be okay to use the mid-range, but if you've got a skewed data set, you don't want to use the mid-range because, if, think back to my little company, most of the people were making $20,000, $25,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000. But if you look only at the custodian, let's say at $10,000, and only the CEO, let's say he makes a relatively modest salary of $125,000 a year, well, the middle of $135,000, $135,000 divided by two, that's still higher than the $50,000 sales reps. So that's still not a good representation of center. So the disadvantage for the mid-range, just like it was for the mean, is that it's sensitive to extremes because it only uses the extremes. So if the extremes are very far from the other data, then it's not good. So it's rarely used. Now we're going to work an example, and you have the example in front of you. Yeah, I think I'm going to do that too, because I think my battery's not running. Tell me to be quiet for him. Okay. Now, you did have at the top part of this one place that you could take some notes, because these were important words to write down. The measures of center. So tell me again, what were the measures of center? Okay, very good. So they're going to ask us here to find from this data set the mean, the median, the mode, and the mid-range. So what we have is the price in dollars for a sample of room air conditioners that are all 10,000 BTUs. And we have one that costs 500, one that costs 840, one that costs 470, one that costs 480, one that costs 420, and two that costs $440. And we want to find the mean. In order to find the mean, we're going to take all those numbers, and since this is a sample, it said at the top that this is a sample, this is X bar, we're going to add up all the prices and divide by the number of the air conditioners. This symbol means sum up, or find the sum of. So it's 512.9? Okay, so you already added them up. And I'm not even going to list them all out, because that's not the important thing. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven of them. 512.9. So the mean is 512.9. Now I want you to look at those air conditioner values. Where does the mean fall? How many of the data values are actually more than the mean?
One.
Just one. How many of them are less than the mean? All the others. Okay, so is the mean a good measure of average for those air conditioner pumps?
No.
No. So we might be better off with the median. So if we're going to find the median, we want to start off with our 420. Yeah, it is 470, because you take your two 440s. And then here's your 470. Here's 480, 500, and then finally the 840. So if I count 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, I can see quickly that 470 is the one that's in the middle. So there's your median. The mode is easy to find, because it's the one that shows up twice. The mid-range is also easy, because the smallest air conditioner is 420. The top is 840.
That's 420.
Hmm? Right, so the difference is 420 divided by 2.
210.
Now wait, you know, not minus, I'm sorry, I said that wrong. That's my bad. 840 plus 420, which is going to be 1260. And 1260 divided by 2 is 630. You could have gotten it that way, but really, you're looking at the halfway point between these two numbers, so the best way to do it is to add them together and divide by 2. Set these off so I can scoop that up, people can see a little bit better. So, Looking at the values themselves, if I ask you, what does an average air conditioner that's 10,000 BTUs cost? What would you tell me? Why? Yeah, but that's not average. It did occur more often. There were two air conditioners that were 440, so that would be a reasonable way to choose. What about the median? It's pretty close to the middle of the data set, so it's a pretty good measure of a typical air conditioner. But as we said, the 512, nope, not so good, because it's more expensive than all but one air conditioner. And the 630 has that same disadvantage. It's more expensive than all of them except one.
458.
What we're going to do on exercise two is we're going to eliminate what we would call an outlier. Now, we don't always eliminate an outlier right up front. But we're going to look at this set of data values and look at this one particular air conditioner because it's about $340 more than all the rest of the air conditioners, or at least it's more than the next highest one. So we think it's pretty far removed from those 400 and some dollar air conditioners. So it's causing a problem. What we're going to do on the next page, or on the next problem, is we're going to look at the same data without the potential outlier, which is the 840. So what we're going to do is we're going to just basically cross it out. Just the 840. And then we're going to try this again. So the mean now becomes 500 plus 470 is 970 plus 480 is 1450 plus 420 is 1870 and then 440 plus 440 is 880. So 1750 divided by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Excuse me?
2750.
Yeah, I forgot to carry my one. Thank you. So 2750 divided by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 air conditioners. Is that a lot more representative of what we would think a typical 10,000 BTU air conditioner would be? Yeah, that looks a lot better. Now the key was not only did we eliminate the 840 from the numerator, but we also did not count it as one of the counts of data in the denominator. The median, again, here's the smallest. We'll come back up here and just do it straight from this. Here's the smallest one, and there's the largest one. Here is the next smallest, and the next largest. So it looks to me like the median is going to be between those two data values, 470 and 440. The easiest way to find out the exact center is to add them together and divide by 2. Yeah, I'll let y'all do the math and tell me.
455?
Yeah. That sounds reasonable.
Merge 440 again. Merge 440.
And the mode stayed the same. It's still 440.
And your range is 470.
And now your range has become the difference between your low of 420 and your high of 500, so it's, oh wait, I'm supposed to be adding those together.
You just,
yeah, I am. Scoot it way up. So that's 920 over 2 which is 460. Okay? Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy over from our first problem what those same values were before we took out that outlier. The mean on the other page was 512.90. The median on the other page was 470. The mode was still 440, it didn't change. The mid-range was 630. So which one of these changed the most? The mean, which means the outlier data affected the mean more than any other data value, excluding the mid-range. The mid-range is always going to be affected more if you remove an outlier because you remove one of the numbers that it's looked at, that you're looking at. Okay? The mean was affected more because the mean contributes to the total, and it contributed a lot. It is, but it says on the bottom, excluding the mid-range. The mid-range is the most influenced. Yeah, you have to read all the way through. I didn't even the first time I did this. Now, what if we had the mean of a frequency distribution? We're going to have to come back and look at that. But for a minute, I'm going to go back to the lesson.
Can I get the access code again? My computer should.
Let me get over here and see what it is.
It's H, and it's A-F-Y.
Okay, before I move on and talk about that, here's the comparison that we just looked at. So 512.86 or 512.90, that's okay too. As opposed to $458.33, $458.33, 470 to 455, 440, stayed 440, and the change in the mean was $54.53. There was change in the median because we did have to shift one of the numbers, but it was only $15 change, and there was no change at all of the mode. So the outliers affected the mean more than any other number except the mid-range. The mid-range is always going to be highly affected by the removal of an outlier because the outlier was one of the numbers it was looking at. Now this is the formula, and again, you don't memorize formulas, you don't really worry about it. We're going to talk about what this means. Assume that all the sample values in each class are equal to the class midpoint. If I've got an interval of values, and I know that it's those values are somewhere between 7 and 12. I don't know how many of them were actually 7, how many of them might have been 9, how many of them might have been 10, how many of them might have been 8. I just know I have some numbers that were in between those two numbers. So what our best guess is just to aim for the center and choose the midpoint of the class interval to be our best guess of what all those numbers really were. And then we have to take into account, and this is the part of the formula that does take into account, that some of the numbers are appearing more often than the others. So the example that we're going to look at is this one. So what I know here is that I have six numbers, and those six numbers are somehow spread out between 7 and 18. So they might be 7, they might be 8, they might be 9, they might be 10, they might be 11, might be 12, might be 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, or 18. I have no idea. They could all have the same value. They could be 3 of 1 and 1 of another, and 1 of a different one. You know, I have no idea what those six numbers are. So I'm going to give it my best guess and say that those six numbers are the midpoint of 7 through 18. So we're going to switch back over to the problem and start doing some calculating. So I don't know what these six numbers are. My best guess for those six numbers is 7 plus 18 divided by 2, which is 25 divided by 2, which is 12.5. That is your midpoint. You add these two, divide by 2. Now, I could do that on every single one of these. I could do 19 plus 30 gives me a sum of whatever and divide by 2, and 31 plus 42 and then divide that by 2. But just to reinforce what we learned in chapter 2, 7 plus what gives me?
12.
That's right. 7 plus 12 gives me 19. 19 plus 12 gives me 31. 31 plus 12 gives me 43, and so forth all the way down that distribution. 18 plus 12 is 30. 30 plus 12 is 42, and it continues all the way down. So that means that the next midpoint is going to be 12 more than the first one. So the second one is going to be 24.5. And the next one will be 36.5. And 48.5. And 60.5. And 72.5. And 84.5. Now, I usually at this point do get the question, well, why don't we just count the midpoint as being 18 plus 19 divided by 2? That comes out to be a whole number. Yeah, it does. And you could do it that way. But that's not truly the middle of these numbers. Because if you actually count those numbers from 7 to 18, 6 of those numbers are 12 or less, and the other 6 are 13 or more. So midway between 12 and 13 is 12.5. So that's the true midpoint. So in order to find the mean, what we're going to do, and I'm going to do this on the calculator, so let me see if I can just scoot this over enough to get the calculator, not covering everything up. Going to turn the calculator on. We're not going to use any fancy lists or anything right now. We're just simply going to go in here and do some arithmetic. So the first thing I want to do is 6 times 12.5. Plus 10 times 24.5. Plus 13 times 36.5 plus 8 times 48.5 plus 5 times 60.5 plus 6 times 72.5 plus 2 times 84.5. Now the reason that I did that is because I know that the midpoint is 12.5, but there's 6 numbers in that category. So I have to count 12.5 6 times for all 6 of those numbers. And I have to count 24.5 10 times because there's 10 numbers in this category. And there's 13 numbers in this category, so it's 13 times my estimate of 36.5. You have to take into account the frequencies. If all you did were add up the midpoints, you just add all of these up and divide by how many? You know what you're going to come out with? 48.5. Because that's assuming that they all showed up with equal counts, but they didn't. The There are a lot more in the second and third class intervals than there are in the others.
So we added up all the midpoints and divided by the number of midpoints, and we got 48.52.
Yes, you would get 48.52.
So we don't have to do all that?
Right? No, you do have to do all that.
No. It's 48.52.
48.5 is not the mean.
Oh, okay.
Okay, and the reason it's not is because there are 6 12.5s, and there are only 2 84.5s. And if you simply add them up and divide by the number of midpoints, you're assuming that you have the same number in that last class that you had in the first class.
That's okay.
And you don't. Okay? No, I haven't yet. Okay? Now, what I've got right now is I've got the sum of all the values, the sum of the F times X's, which is 2089. But I also have to divide by how many total numbers I had. 16, 29, and if I sum all these up, it is 50 values. So I'm going to divide my 2089 by 50. And my mean turns out to be 41.78. We're going to look at where that is. Falls just barely, because this one ends at 42, but it falls in this category, which happens to have the majority or the highest count for all of the different categories. So it falls in this category, not in this one. And that's because these counts are, let's see, that's 13 and 6 and 2. These counts are a lot more than if you add all four of these up together. Because there's 29 in those top three, and 21 in these bottom four. So that's why your mean has to be closer to the center point. Remember, it's a measure of center. So it has to make sense. So the center of all these different numbers isn't 48.5. It's actually a little less than that. Okay?
And you're not rounding that number, correct? Not rounded?
I did not. You can. Since the date of A, we could make the assumption here. We don't actually know what the data looks like. We have no clue. Because all we know is that the lowest one was 7. We don't even know that the highest one was 90, because it could have been only 80 and still fit in that class. So we only know the lowest value is 7. We don't know what maybe the next value was, 15.4 and 9.72. So in this case, I can leave it with 2 decimals, or at best, I'm going to round it to 1. I'm not going to round it to 42, okay, because I don't even know what these data look like. So I try to avoid guessing any more than I have to. Now, believe it or not, you can find the median or a good estimate of the median from this frequency distribution. If you have 50 numbers, and you're looking for exactly halfway between those 50 numbers, starting at the first number and ending with the 50th number, what's the middle going to be? Okay, you want 1 through 25 here. And 26 through 50 is going to be on this side. So your actual midpoint is going to be 25.5. Okay? So it's going to be between the 25th and the 26th number. It's not going to be 25.5, because that would put it in this category. That's not right. We're looking for the 25th and 26th number. Okay, here I've got, and this is, goes back to cumulative frequency. The first two categories taken together are the first 16 numbers. When I get to the next 13, by the time I get this far down, I have 29 of the numbers. So my first 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 is right there. My 17th number is in here. My 18th number is in there. My 19th number is in there. My 20th number is in there. My 21st number is in there. My 22nd number is in there. The 23rd number is in there. The 24th number is in there. And the 25th number is in there, as well as 26, 27, 28, and 29th number. So I know that my best guess of the middle is the median of that category that has number 24 and 25 of the data. So my best guess is it's 36.5. You're basing it strictly on the counts. Where would the 24th and 25th number be? And for that, you're looking at the frequencies. You're not looking at the values themselves. Okay? Questions? Is everybody okay with this so far?
So you just add up all of the frequencies.
I just accumulate the frequencies as I go down until I get a number that's bigger than the 25 and the 26. And then I know when I got that number, that's the category that that 25th and 26th number fell into.
And 29, these are the 25. So you just take
right.
That midpoint and that's your median.
Right, that's the median. That's my guess of the median. Now, yes.
I'm sorry. So I'm kind of confused why you're finding the median. So I'm just lost.
Okay. Let me try this. I think this might help. Pull these off of here for a second. Get just a plain sheet of white paper. And go back to a real simple example that would be easy for you to figure out by counting. Suppose this is my data set. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 numbers. Where's the middle of those 13 numbers without making a frequency distribution? Who's in the middle?
6.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If you have an odd number of data values, it's going to be one of the numbers that's actually in the middle. Okay? Well, and that still led you to where this is because that's in the 6.5 position. It's in the middle of the 6 and the 7. Okay, now let me make a frequency distribution of this. And my first category is going to be 1 to 3. My second category is going to be 4. And since I'm adding 3 there, I want to add 3 here, so it'll be 4 to 6. And then 4 plus 3 will be 7. And 6 plus 3 will be 9. So my last category is going to be 10 to 12. We okay there? So those are my class limits. Now here's my frequencies. How many numbers from 1 to 3? There they are. There's 4. From 4 to 6? There's 3. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in that one, and only 1 in the last one. Okay? Now, we know what the median is for sure. So if we're starting to count here, number 1, 2, 3, and 4 are in that group. Number 5, 6, 7, are in this group. Fifth one, sixth one, and seventh one. Okay? There's five in this group, so this is going to be the 8th one, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, and so forth. But I know the middle of 13 numbers. Is going to be halfway between number 6 and number 7. Or it's going to be at 6.5, at the 6.5 mark. It's going to be between the 6th one and the next one up. Well, okay, if I'm looking for the 6th one and the 7th one and the 8th one, I'm going to be looking, here's 4 plus 3, I've got 7 numbers right there. That means it had to be in that category. And it was. Because from 1 through 6, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 numbers. And this tells me I have 4 plus 3 is 7 numbers. Okay, so number 6 and number 7 are both in that group. And that's why 6 is the median. Does that make it easier to understand why I did it the other way? You're looking at the counts and recovering the counts. You don't actually have this for the other data set. But this at least lets you see how this and this are related to each other.
So,
okay.
I have a question. So we can do these on the calculator except for the modes.
For the modes, you're going to have to count. Now, if you've got Excel, Excel will give you the mode. It'll count for you. But the calculator does not have a mode command.
It does, but it's mode.
Yeah. It's a strange mode. Has nothing to do with statistics. Okay, so it says here to find the mode. Do we have the data to know how often any one particular number showed up?
Yes, the frequencies.
We have frequencies, but do they tell us how many of each individual value there are?
No.
No, so you find the mode?
No.
No, can't find it. There is a mode in that data set. We don't know what it is because we don't have the data. We've got a summary of it. Okay, we don't have the actual raw data. But, yeah, you'd have to know what these 6 numbers were and what these 10 numbers were exactly, not a guess. These are guesses. But we can find something called the modal class. Which class has the highest frequency? Okay, so this is your modal class. So while you can't find an actual mode, you can find what's called a modal class, a class that has the highest frequency. Okay? Now we're going to talk about something called a weighted mean. And it's going to kind of reinforce what we were talking about here. Now before I go back to the Nearpod lesson, let's look at these grades. What you're going to hope they look like.
Yeah.
Okay? Consider that for this class, your test average, and I'm not going to go through the weights, okay, but you notice here that the test average is half of your grade, and the lab assignments are 10%, homework's 5%, midterm's 15%, and the final exam's 20%. But you're just looking at your grades. You don't usually think about the weight. I know you don't. You're just looking at your grades. And you say, okay, my test average is 86. And my homework grade is 100. Yay for me. And my lab average is 98. I'm happy about that because those are both really close to 100. And my midterm was a 96. Boy, that's close to 100. And I made an 82 on the final exam. Add those up and divide by 5. So you sat there and you made that calculation, and you're all happy and excited. You think, I made an A! I made an A in the class! Okay, now here's what actually happens then when you get your grade report. You didn't make an A. You made a B. Okay? You made a B in this class, if this was you. Now, it's not a bad B. It's actually a really good B. It's a high B, but it's still a B. It's not an A. And here's why. When you do a weighted mean, you take the weight and multiply it times that particular average and add to the weight times the next grade plus the weight times your homework average here plus the weight for your lab is, so we already got that. Your grade on your midterm is 15%, so 0.15 times your 96. Plus your final exam is an 82, but it counts 20%. So before I actually total that up, notice that this grade counted for more than counted for half of your grade. And this grade added to that grade counts for 70% of your grade. So 70% of your grade is from an 86 and an 82. Okay? So when you actually add those up, you have an 88.6. Okay? When we did that frequency distribution, we were doing the same thing. We were taking into account how many of some of those values we had, and the ones that had more, the classes that had the higher counts had to have more weight in the final average. And this just makes it a little more obvious to you. Okay? So your grade's still not bad, but it just wasn't what you wanted it to be. Well, fine. Get out from there. So this is how you compute the weighted mean. You take the weights, which could be the frequencies. It doesn't have to be decimals and percentages. It can be just weights for the category. And divide by the total number of the weights. And in our case, the total number of the weights would have been 1. Because if you add up all those decimals, you get 1. And there is a way to do it more quickly. I will tell you that. But we're ready to talk about measures of variation. And there are three that we're going to look at. The first one is called the range. Second one's called the standard deviation. And the third one's called the variance. And I will tell you up front that this one is related to that one very, very strongly. The variance and the standard deviation are very, very close cousins. In fact, you can't get the standard deviation without the variance if you're doing a formula by hand. Variation. Give me some synonyms for variation. What does variation mean?
Change.
Differences.
Yeah, differences. Change from one to another. How things are spread out from one another. We're talking about numbers, how they're spread out from each other. Oh, I made my iPod bad now. My iPad. So I can't get the lesson to go.
You about ready for a break?
Yes.
Okay. We can still talk about this, though, because, and I'm not going to try to keep you for too long. We are going to take a break shortly, but let's talk about this. Let my iPad try to recuperate. It's worked hard today. Okay, let's look at this problem, and we're not going to do any math to look at it. Okay. Let's suppose that you supervise two delis. Let's talk about food since that's important to all of us. Let's suppose you supervise two delis. And they both those delis sell bacon. They sell good bacon. Everything's better with bacon. You don't want any bacon to go to waste. That would be a bad thing. Never let bacon go to waste. And it's important that the two managers hold a steady inventory. Why?
So no bacon goes wasted.
So no bacon goes wasted. They will sell all the bacon out before it goes bad. And you also do not want customers coming in your deli saying, I need bacon. And they're being told, we don't have any bacon in our house. Okay, so you need to have a steady inventory of bacon. You decide to analyze the boxes of bacon that the managers ordered in the last 6 weeks and take the average of each one to see how they're doing. So each manager orders around 32 boxes of bacon a week. This is manager A and this is manager B, 32.3 and 32.8. So that's not bad. They're ordering about, on average, the same amount of bacon every week. And on the surface, it looks like, hey, they're both doing a good job. But they're not.
Yeah, one's doing a really lousy
job.
Very consistent, one's very.
If you look closer, you'll see one of the managers has weekly orders of 22, then 34, then 58, then 52, then 10, then 21. Whereas the other manager consistently orders around 32, 33 pounds of bacon a week. His orders are very consistent, which tells me that probably what's happening with this top deli is that his customers are coming in and buying the amount of bacon that he predicted they were going to buy, and then he has a set amount that he reorders when he realizes when he's going to run out. So he's really got a handle on how to run that deli. This guy, he only ordered 22 pounds.
This is the English deli for you.
Okay. He only ordered 22 pounds of bacon. Before the next order could even be put in, people had bought all that bacon and people are lined up at the counter saying, where is the bacon? And he says, I don't have any, we're out.
Well, maybe that turkey had a special.
It could be, we'll talk about that. So then, the next week he thinks, geez, you know, I sold all 22, maybe I better order some extra. So he orders 34. Well, because some people had run out the week before, they come in and buy it all up. So again, he runs out. So the next week he says, oh, geez, I'm going to order 58 boxes of bacon this week. So he orders 58 boxes of bacon, and they all sold out. So the next week he orders 52, and he was stuck with a whole lot of bacon. Because by that time, people had stocked their supplies with bacon from his store. And the next week, he only ordered 10 because he still had bacon left over from the week before. Do you want week old bacon?
Yes.
Well, I would eat it, but I would not be as happy as if it were fresh. I don't turn down bacon. But then again, he ordered 10. And then the next week, he could only order 21 because, again, he did not sell out of bacon. So now at this point, he's selling 2 week old bacon. Anybody ever smell 2 week old bacon? Yeah, it doesn't smell very good. It doesn't taste good either. So, in the end, who do you want to buy from? This deli? Or this one?
Deli A.
Deli A. Because they have fresh bacon regularly. Deli B is either out of bacon or he's got rotten bacon. Okay? So you don't want to buy from Deli B. This is why you look not just at the average, because on the surface of the average it says, well, they're both about even. But if you look beyond the average and look at how the volatility of his ordering is for Deli Manager B, he might need to be fired, or at least trained better. Okay? This is why we would talk about something called standard deviation. Because Deli B here has a much, much, much higher standard deviation than Deli A. There is very little variation from week to week in what he orders. Whereas here there are huge amounts of variation from week to week. Okay, good. This is where I hope to be. We're going to do one very short problem by hand, and then from here on out we're going on the calculator. So after we do this one problem by hand, so that you understand how to do and what you're doing, we're going to calculate a couple of standard deviations. And I'm not going to show you the formula. I'm just going to show you how. Okay? This is a population. Nope. Just write this one down. It won't take much. This is a population. Anybody want to guess what the population is? Nope. Any gamblers?
Oh, a six-sided die.
A six-sided die. If you roll a six-sided die, the outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. And they show up about an equal number of times. If you roll it 100 times, 1/6 of the time it ought to be 1. 1/6 of the time it ought to be 2. 1/6 of the time it ought to be 3. 1/6 of the time it should be 4.
Unless you can pitch it.
Or you can shake it up in the can, whatever you want to do. But it should show up relatively a uniform number of times. Okay? I'm ignoring you, Brandon. This population has a mean. Do you know what the mean is? Mean is 3.5. Okay, and it is mu because it is a population mean. Now we're going to calculate the population standard deviation by hand one time. This one's going to be harder than the other one I'm going to have you do. Use your calculator. This is how you calculate. The values of your variable are always called x. The variable in this case is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are the values. I want to talk about the amount on average that each one of these numbers differs from the mean. One is different from the mean by about 2.5. It is 2.5 below the mean. Okay? 1 minus 3.5, 1 minus the mean is negative 2.5. 2 is different from the mean by 1.5. 3 is different from the mean. By exactly negative 0.5.
Yeah.
4 is different from the mean. Also by 0.5, but it's above the mean, so it's positive. So keep in mind, these are all negative because they're below the mean. 5 is different from 3.5 by 1.5, but again, it's above the mean, so that difference is positive. And 6 is different from 3.5 by 2.5 because it is above the mean by 2.5. Here's my question for you, and I think you can figure this out. What's the mean difference? What's the average, what you think of as the normal average? What is the mean of these differences? How would you calculate the mean? How do you always calculate the mean?
Add it up and divide.
Okay, add those up and divide by 6 differences. Add them up and divide by 6. Tell me what you get. But it's important to realize that. What's 0 divided by 6? 0. Okay, 0 divided by 6? 0? That implies that there is no difference in any of these numbers and that one. Is that true?
Yes.
No, it obviously is not. There's not a single one of those that has that value. And yet we calculated an average, right? What you thought of as a mean or an average. What happened? They canceled out because these were below the mean by the exact same amount that these were above the mean. And that's always going to happen if you try to calculate the average difference of all the data values from the mean, trying that technique. Because the thing is, what the mean does is it takes every single one of those numbers into account, and it finds the exact balance point where if you put all those numbers on a seesaw, that all of these bottom numbers below the mean would balance out all the ones on the top side of the mean, and they would be in equilibrium. That's what the mean does. That's its job. So you're not going to be able to get at the standard deviation by using that particular calculation. What caused these to cancel each other out? One little thing. What caused 3 of them to cancel out the other 3?
Negative
signs. How can you get rid of negative signs? There's 2 ways. Well, you can take the absolute value of them. Take the absolute value because the absolute value of negative numbers. Okay? Oh, no. We got another one? Trade out for a different one. I think these are actually pretty old. They've been here a long time. Okay, if you take the absolute value of negative numbers, what do you get? Positive numbers. So my first thought is, well, I should just take the absolute value of all those and then problem solved. The problem is, if I do that for statistical reasons that you are not interested in, it won't work. It causes some other problems further down the line just by taking that absolute value, because there's no way to unabsolute value the absolute value. There's no way to go backwards from having done that. But what's the other thing I could do to all these negative numbers and make the answer come out to be positive? I could multiply all of these numbers by themselves. I could square them, because if you square a number, is the result ever negative?
No,
it's always positive. So what is negative 2.5 squared?
Put it in parentheses if you're going to do it that way. Okay. What's 1.5 squared, or negative 1.5? 2.25? Is that right? And 0.5 squared is 0.25.
Does it get smaller?
So then this 0.5, just because this one was positive, or this one was negative and this one was positive, they're still going to come out positive. So 0.25 for that one. 2.25 for that one. And 6.25 for that one. And I'll add these numbers up, because you didn't put your negative number in parentheses before you squared it. It was only squaring the number, not the negative sign. So here I have, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's 1.5, 7.5, 8, 9.5, 10, 11.5, plus 16. What does this add up to, or plus 6? Add those up for me. Seventeen point five. Usually I can too, but after this late in the day, the caffeine ran out a long time ago. I know. This is the way I had to learn how to do it. Okay. The sum of the squared differences is 17.5. If I take the sum of the squared differences and divide by the number of differences, I get 17.50 over 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and I get 2.9. Are any of these numbers 2.9 away from 3.5?
No.
Why is that number so big? Because we squared the differences. Okay? This is not the average difference either, because these are all squared. The actual differences were like 2.5, 1.5, 0.5, 0.5, 1.5, 2.5. This is bigger than any of those. And that's because we squared these numbers to get these, and that's where this came from. So what we have to do is unsquare. How do you unsquare something?
Square root it.
You square root it.
1.7 with a 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 2.
We'll round it off to three decimal places. The population standard deviation is 1.707.
703.
Yeah,
707. 703.
I've got 1.7
Okay, I'll buy that. This is the main thing to focus on, though, because I really am only interested in one decimal place. Once you keep that in mind. Now, bear with me for just a couple more minutes. Remember, this is population. Okay, we are capable of understanding what that population was, that it was the result of rolling a die. It's the actual population of bays that can occur if you do that. Let's roll a die. Let's roll it 10 times. It's kind of odd to have a sample that's bigger than the population of values, but it is still a sample. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to roll it for all of us.
I'm going to go to random integer.
1, 5, 6.
And I'm going to start with 1, end with 6. And since I want 10 numbers, and I don't care if the same number comes up twice, because it's going to have to. I've only got 6 values, and if I roll 10 times, one of them's got to repeat. In fact, several of them got to repeat. I'm going to go ahead and ask it for all 10 numbers.
That's what the lotto machine does.
So this is my sample I got from rolling that die 10 times. So there's the numbers that I got. Here's my sample. We need to find the mean of this sample. Now this is just right. I could have just as easily brought in a die and rolled it out on this screen 10 times and written down the number. I'm just using the calculator because I didn't want to carry the dice in here. So I rolled, the first time I rolled a 1, then I rolled a 3, then I rolled a 6, then I rolled a 5, then I rolled a 4, and then another 4, and then I rolled a 6, and then another 5, and another 5, and another 4. One thing that you should notice is there's not a single 2 in this.
There are a lot of 5s and a lot of 4s.
There's lots of 5s and lots of 4s, but not a single 2 and only 1, 1, and 1, 3. That's kind of a... It seems odd, but that is a perfectly legal roll. That's what could happen if you roll a die 10 times. But just pay attention to the fact that we got more of the higher values than we did the lower ones. 1 plus 3 is 4. 4 plus 6 is 10. 15, 19, 23, 29, 34, 39, 43.
Sure.
Somebody check. Okay. The sum of my dice rolls is 43 divided by the number of my dice rolls, which was 10, gives me X bar, which is 4.3. Okay, I know it's hard to see from back there. I hate the way they mounted this. Okay, there's the mean of this sample. So what I'm going to do is what same thing I did before. You should do the same thing too. 1 minus 4.3. 3 minus 4.3. 6 minus 4.3. 5 minus 4.3. 4 minus 4.3. 4 minus 4.3. 6 minus 4.3. 5 minus 5, or 4.3, 5 minus 4.3, 4 minus 4.3. Trying to get it as high up as I can so y'all can see it without having to break your necks. So 1 minus 4.3 was negative 3.3. This was negative 1.3. This is going to be negative 1.7. And 0.7. Oh, wait, that's not going to be negative. That's going to be positive. This one turns out to be negative 0.3. This is positive 1.7. This is positive 0.7. This is positive 0.7. And this is negative 0.3. And will you trust me if I tell you that if I add up all these negative and positive numbers that I'm going to get, guess what? Zero. Because they offset each other. So I'm going to have to do exactly what I did a minute ago. Some of these I know I can do in my head, but some I can't. So negative 3.3 squared is going to be 10.89. And 1.3 squared is going to be 1.69. And this is going to be 2.89. That's going to be 0.49. So I'm going to put the top of the column up here so you'll know what we were doing. This is our differences. And this is our differences squared. So this is the column. This last column is the one that we really need to add up. So the sum of my squared differences is 20.1, and I have 10 differences, so I'm going to divide that by 10 2.01. And get 2.01. And I'm going to square root 2.1 just like I square rooted before to unsquare all those squarings that I did and see what the square of 2.01 is.
1.42.
Okay, Brandon says it's 1.42. That far enough? A little bit more? It's done the same way, but I want you to look at something. So this actually does round to 1.42 down here. Okay? Now, I want you to compare. This is the whole reason for going through all of this arithmetic by hand, which we will never do again. I just want you to get a concept. The original population standard deviation, and I'm going to take this to be 1.4 rather than worry about the 2 right now, but the actual population standard deviation was 1.7. Are those the same? No. Obviously, 1.4 and 1.7 are not equal. You're 0.3 difference in those two. This is bigger than this one. Right? But now here's the problem. I want you to come back and look at the numbers again.
You don't have the 2 in there.
There's no twos.
But there's a multiple.
There is a bunch of fours and fives and sixes, but only two of the numbers fall to the three or less.
It's skewed.
Our sample is not terribly representative of the population, but it was a random sample. Okay, it was a random sample, but it is not as representative of the population as I would have liked. There is less variability in this sample than there was in the entire population. The sample standard deviation's job is to estimate the population standard deviation. The sample standard deviation's job, let's go back to the whole reason we do statistics. You can't get to the population.
No.
It's too big, too expensive, too time consuming. So we take a sample. We want to use the sample, which is a small piece of the population, to estimate values about the population. The mean wasn't too bad, 4.3 compared to 3.5. That wasn't awful. The reason it's easy to see why the mean was higher. But our standard deviation was a lot smaller than for the population. Now here's why. The actual population contained these in equal quantities and our sample did not. The truth of the matter is, if you are sampling from a population, and it doesn't matter if it's distributed like a roll of a die, or if a lot of things are around the center and there's only a few really high and really low values, chances are when you take your sample, no matter how hard you try or how good a random sample you take, your sample is not going to contain the lowest population value, and it's not likely to contain the highest ones. It's likely to consist of values that are closer to the middle, the normal, the expected, okay? Which means those values are going to be more like each other than all of the population values are like each other. That means that this standard deviation is always going to underestimate the population standard deviation if we use that formula. But we can improve the ability of that formula to estimate by one small change. We're still going to take the sum of the x minus x bars that have been squared, but rather than dividing by n over here, we're going to divide by n minus 1. The reason we're going to divide by n minus 1 is because if we lose one of the sample size, we're dividing by a smaller number. And if you divide a large quantity by a smaller number, you will get something that's going to be a lot more comparable to that 1.17. So if I take the square root of 2.01 divided by 6 instead of 7, not 2.01. Sorry. It's not 6. My brain leaped. We started out with 10 differences, so I'm going to use 9 to divide that 20.1 by.
What? Oh, 20.1.
So if I take my sum, which is 20.1, and rather than dividing by 10, I divide by 9, watch what happens. Now it's still not quite big enough, but it's a lot closer. Okay?
Yeah. What's that? What's the point of that?
What's the point of reducing the sample size by one?
Yeah.
It makes it a better estimator. That's all I can tell you is it makes it a better estimator. Yes, it's still underestimated because by luck our sample had values that were very, very close together, and only a few of the lower extremes. By luck, the next time we were to do this, we might get a lot of ones and twos and threes and not get very many fives and sixes. They would still have a similar standard deviation. Now, you never have to do this by hand again. What I wanted you to get was, number one, the reason that there is a difference in that formula and the population formula is because that n minus 1 makes this a better estimator of what you're trying to estimate. I can do a mathematical proof and prove it to you, and y'all would not even want to be sitting on the because you don't care. When I was sitting where you are, I didn't care. Just, okay, this is a formula, fine. I'll take it on faith on the other formula, let's go. So I didn't care if they proved it to me. But I was in graduate school for statistics, and I had to learn the proof.
But we didn't learn.
Because you do not. You do not need to ever have to do that again. What I wanted you to get from that is that what standard deviation is it's the average amount that the data values are different from the mean. That's what it actually measures. And the formula causes us to have to do some strange things to actually get at that. We're going to graduate to the calculator for the rest of it. Okay? Take a break. Come back at 1:45. We are now unpaused. So here's what I want you to do. Now that we've talked about what standard deviation measures, I want you to give me a list of five numbers separated by commas that would have a very small standard deviation. What do you think has a small standard deviation?
Five numbers.
Not a zero standard deviation, a small standard deviation.
I don't know what you mean.
Small variability. They're all very, very close to whatever the mean would be. You don't want them all to be the same number, but you want them, you can use the same number more than once.
You want it on the iPad?
It should,
yeah.
You should be able to type it.
You should be able to type it in on the iPad.
So.
Now, I'm not going to be able to give you feedback on these until I get back to my office and download the report, and then I'll give you individual feedback on these. Because I'm not going to show everybody's answers to everybody else. That's not fair.
Five
numbers that you think have a very small standard deviation.
These numbers can mean
they can be whatever you choose. They can be single-digit numbers. They can be big numbers, little numbers, but they have to not vary very much. They have to have small standard deviation.
They have to be whole numbers.
I don't care what they are. They can be any kind of numbers you want them to be. Positive numbers, negative numbers, decimals, fractions, little numbers, big numbers. The key is that you want them to have small standard deviation collectively. And you need five of them. That would work depending on the numbers. Remember when we were counting the differences, what we were looking at? We were looking at differences that were very small from the mean. This is not an easy question. I'm not pretending that it is. But it helps me to understand. You're not being graded on this. It helps me understand whether or not you understand what standard deviation was measuring. Okay? And actually, maybe I can do this from up here. I'll just turn the projector off for a minute. Because I logged in on a different browser to do this. And according to my list, okay, I'm not seeing anybody that's left the presentation.
Do we need to exit out of the presentation?
No, you need to stay in it. You need to stay in it. But I am seeing your answers. Mm-hmm. Now, you're the only one that's seeing your own answers. You don't?
Kind of. They're behind thank you.
You can go back and change them at this point if you want to.
can't?
No.
Okay. If I accidentally flip back, you can. But, okay. All right. Now, I'm just going to pick some of these and talk about whether they're good or bad. I'm not picking on anybody. I'm not looking at names. I'm looking at what you submitted. Okay? Remember, I said I wanted something with small standard deviation. And most of you have done a very good job. Because you all did small numbers, but that wasn't the key. Small numbers are just easier to think about what the difference is from one to another. You could have used, and one person up here has 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. That person could have just as easily used 10, 11, 13, 14. You know, it's the difference in those numbers, not the numbers themselves, that create the small standard deviation. You want numbers that were close together. So some of these really good examples that y'all have put in here is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, that one's really good. That's smaller than 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 because some of the numbers were repeated. 2, 3, 5, 4, 6, that's close. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, just threw me an extra number and that's okay. 21, 25, 27, 29, 31. Now that standard deviation is not as small as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 because those numbers were two apart, which is a bigger difference. So that's a little larger, but it's still a relatively small standard deviation. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 2, 3, 3, 4, 4. That's another good one. That has smaller standard deviation than 1, 2, 3, 4, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then I see one here, 1, 1, 2, 3, 3. That's a good one. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 is a little bit too much difference between the numbers. It's not the value of the numbers themselves, but those numbers are 5 apart. And that's the variation, that's the variability. So if I were to calculate the mean of those numbers, the mean would probably be 15. So 5 is 10 units different from 15, and 10 is 5 units difference. So those average differences are going to be a lot bigger than what the others were. But that was still a good thought about trying to keep your variation small. And there was one here. You do not want to use the same number for all 5 of your entries. Okay, you don't want to use something like 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. Because 2 is no different from 2, is no different from 2, is no different from 2, is no different from the next 2. So the standard deviation of that one would be 0. There is no difference in all the numbers, which you might want to remember as we move on. Give a list of 5 numbers separated by commas that have a large standard deviation. If your near part freezes, you can get out of it and then go right back in. Let me give you the code again.
H-X-A-F-Y.
Yes, H-X-F-A-F-Y. Well, now I have to go back and read it again. Still got some people thinking. I see some good ones here, though.
You just have to tell me what the last number is.
Actually, the last number is one of the biggest reasons it's so very, very good. Mm-hmm. I'll be tempted to share your answer. I may share your answer.
Okay, anybody need more time? Anybody need more time? Okay, let me talk to you about some good examples here. $1,500, $2,000, $1,500, $2,000. Those numbers are spread out by hundreds, so that's good. $11, $22, $33, $44, $55. They're spread out quite a bit. And then I've got $250, $500, $750, $1,000, $1,250. That's a good one. Those are nicely spread out. Now, if I don't call out yours, it doesn't mean your answer was bad, okay? I'm looking for the ones that are kind of striking me as being a really, really large standard deviation. Because everybody I'm seeing here has the concept. 14, 27,456, 153, 17,746, 726,526,546.
Still didn't beat me.
But the prize winner of all is Mr. Booker. He doesn't even know how to say that last number, and neither do I. Okay, but that last number is really, 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 really huge in comparison to the very first number, which was one. And it's pretty huge compared to the others as well. Okay. So we are now ready to move on to the next question. We have come up with examples of data sets that have a large and a small standard deviation. Let's see if I can get the screen lit back up. And I'll just review for you a quick way. If it'll come back on, I might kill it.
We might get to go home and dial on.
No, it's coming. There it goes.
We're talking about throwing rocks at buildings today in physics and told them that I wanted to be a rock at that point in class.
Okay, examples of a data set that has a small standard deviation. We all got several of them. Y'all had some really good examples. Some of the better ones, some of the best ones that I saw. Were like that. Not just small numbers, it would have been the same. If you kept the same number of zeros on every one, even though the numbers were huge themselves, the point is there's very little difference between the numbers. Okay, so we're looking at the actual differences here.
Deviation.
The differences are small. Small differences make small standard deviation. Okay? If you want a large standard deviation, then you want large differences.
Such as 1,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,
So those numbers are very, very different from each other. There are large differences. It's large differences between the data values, not the value of the data numbers itself, because one's pretty small, and seven, whatever that is pretty big. The one that at first, most students think is challenging, and yet if you don't overthink it, is the one that says the standard deviation is zero. And the standard deviation of zero simply means that on the average, none of the data values are different from each other. So that's the easy one to get. One, 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 one. The differences are all zero. Or as long as it's all the same number, it doesn't matter what the number itself is. Because the truth of the matter is, the mean doesn't measure the same thing as what standard deviation does. Standard deviation doesn't care about the actual values of the data values themselves. It cares about what the difference is from one to another. Okay? Now, I promised you you would never, ever, ever have to do that again. And we aren't. Get your calculator and turn it on. Let's clear off the home screen. Press stat. And when everybody's there, look up. Press stat. S-T-A-T. It's right below the delete key. When you are at stat, choose number one, which is edit. We've done this before. I don't care what's in list two because we're not going to use list two. So we're going to ignore list two. I'm going to use list one. And into list one, I'm going to enter 73, 95, 235, 192, 165 until I have entered in all of those numbers. Type over the top of them. Kick them out. You can if you want to, but there's no need to. And it doesn't matter if you go down the columns or across the rows. You can go whichever way you want to. Order does not matter. Accuracy does matter. And that last one is zero. Yes? Is there still some left? Hit delete until those all go away. There is another way to get rid of data and get a clean list, but every time I've shown people that this close to a test, they manage to delete their list during the test and then they panic and it just totally messes up their exam. So I will show you that, but I'll show you that later. Okay, now, does everybody have their data in list one? I do not care what's in list two. Is your data in list one and is it accurate? Double check. So here's step one. This is what we've completed. Go to stat. And you press enter because you want to edit. And then type the data values. And type the data values into one list. And in our case, we used L1. Now I'm going to write down the sequence of steps and then I'm going to go through them to give you a chance to stay caught up. So in order to find these first two,
step.
Now, I'm going to go through that much of it with you, and then I'll write down the next steps. Okay? So you press the stat button, enter to edit. I'm sorry, no, that's typing the list down. I need to jump down here. Press the stat button, right to the calculate menu. Calc stands for calculate. We're going to calculate formulas. Choose number one, one bar stats, and it puts that on your home screen. Does anybody have an 84 that doesn't look like this at this point? Okay, let me see how yours looks to see if I need to modify what I'm going to tell anybody. Okay, you're okay, sit tight. Okay, y'all sit tight. What I'm about to do is the same thing you're going to need to do.
Okay.
What's wrong is somebody just played around the bottom of the other class. Okay. Those of you that have the 84, you're going to do the same thing next that I do. You're going to press second and one to get list one in that entry. The rest of you just hit second and one.
Yes.
Now, at this point, all of the 83 people are going to hit enter. The 84 people have something that says frequency list. Leave it blank. If it won't let you leave it blank, put a 1 in it.
Go ahead and hit enter, right?
Yeah, you can go ahead and hit enter. Or down arrow until you get to calculate. Hit calculate and see what it does, because I want to make sure it'll actually do it without anything in that list. Yep, it did. Okay, so when I ask you for frequency list right now, unless we got a frequency distribution, you leave that blank. Okay? The mean of this distribution, which is X bar, and the reason that it is accurately X bar is because it says listed in the table are the durations and hours of a simple random sample, so it's going to be X bar. Is 217.3 repeating. And we're just going to call that 217.3. The reason that we are is because all of these data values that we entered in for the shuttle times were in whole hours. So we're going to round it to one decimal place more than the mean, more than the actual data, which means that it goes to one decimal. That's actually four significant figures. So we're going to use the number of decimal places in the actual data that you're using plus one. If the data has no decimal places, your mean has one decimal place. If your data had one decimal place, then your mean would have two. Okay? If it's money, then your mean is going to have three decimal places because money is two decimal places. Then it says find the standard deviation. You have to read the problem to know which one of these two standard deviations that you should report. And if you tell me the wrong one, I'm going to count it wrong because I expect you to read the problem. Our data is from a sample. So we are going to use a statistic, which is S. So we're going to choose this number, the 105.92.
Anytime it's a sample, it'll be the SS.
Yes. Sample is always the English letters Greek is always for the population. If this had been all of the space shuttle flights, then we would have looked at sigma as being the standard deviation. Notice they're different numbers.
No.
What this actually is, this funny looking thing here,
that's
the sum of all your data values. If you were to actually add up all these numbers, they would add up to 3,260. Then it's this.
Okay.
That funny looking little O thing with a little curly thing sticking off of it, that's a sigma. That's a lowercase Greek S.
Wouldn't it be 105.9
because you rounded one decimal place? I rounded it to two decimal places because, now this is my rule of thumb. If StatLab tells you to do something different, you do what it tells you. But my rule of thumb is one extra decimal place for the mean and two extra decimal places for the standard deviation. Okay?
So why would that not be 106?
Because we don't want to round it to a whole number. We don't want to round the mean to a whole number either. Our data values are whole numbers. These are only estimates of what is typical or average. Okay? Now the last one says find the variance. I'm going to back up for just a second. Don't anybody shudder or cry. When we did this, this quantity right here is called the variance. It's the last step of the standard deviation before you take the square root.
Before
you take the square root. It's while everything is still squared. So here's the relationship between the standard deviation and the variance. S squared is the symbol for the variance. S is the symbol for the standard deviation. S is the square root of S squared. So if you have S and you want the variance, you square it. Okay? So the variance is S squared.
112.195.
And there's two ways that you can do it, and either one of these is perfectly acceptable to me. One is to look at that number right there that you just told me, but type in all those decimals. And then square that number. And your variance is 112.19.09523.
Close enough. That seemed to move a 346.
Yeah, you just square it. Okay, I may have to figure a way around for y'all. Let me see what we get. Second out. And I see if you can type the standard deviation. I want to see what it does. 105. Okay, it leaves. Okay, let me show you how you can get it. So those of you that have the 84 and you're trying to square that number, and as soon as you start typing, that all disappears. You could write it down, which is annoying.
Yeah.
Or the other way you can do it is you hit, remember that VARS key? Have we ever used the VARS key yet?
No.
Okay, the VARS key is going to be your friend later. The VARS key is kind of diagonally from statistics. If you hit the VARS key, the VAR is actually the variables that the calculator knows how to store. And if you'll go down to statistics, if you want the variance, it's on one of these lists.
It's on the sum.
No. Okay, the next best thing is to go down that list and pick out your sample standard deviation, hit enter, and hit your x squared. And you'll notice that the last decimal place is just a little teeny tiny bit different, because it could see decimals that we couldn't see on the screen. Okay? So the best option for you may be to write down that number, because this it's not necessary to use the statistics variables menu.
So we just write that number down and then go
in and just go in and type it in and square it.
Okay.
Okay, that'll be fine. So we didn't do any arithmetic, all we did was type in numbers, and that's what we're gonna do from here on out. So let me go back to the Nearpod for a second. And this is just a note to help you remember that if you need the variance, if you've got the standard deviation, just square it to get the variance. And this is the example that we just did. And we're now at something called the range rule of thumb. And this sort of relates to something that Amy said a few minutes ago. For a lot of data sets, the vast majority of the values in that data set are going to be within two standard deviations of the mean. So the minimum usual value is going to be the mean minus two standard deviations, and the usual maximum value is the mean plus two standard deviations. And that's very often written as mean, and I'm going to switch over here in a minute, mean plus or minus two standard deviations. You're thinking quartiles, and that's coming up. Okay, so now that I've got that, make sure that this is what you wrote in that box. This mean plus or minus two standard deviations. Or you can write both of these, whichever one you want to. And then I'm going to show you an example of what that's used for. Okay, and I can go back to it if you need it, but I want to actually, I think it makes more sense if you can see what it's used for. This is the original set of data that we've just been looking at, okay? You probably still got it in your calculator. We've got values like 73 and 95. We have some that are in the higher hundreds, the middle hundreds. Then we've got some that are 235 and 259 and 381 and 331 and 221 and 244. What was this?
Zero.
Why is that zero?
There
was no flight duration. How many of y'all are old enough to remember the Challenger space shuttle? Okay. How long was it in flight?
0 seconds.
Didn't make it. Is that unusual?
Yes.
That's very unusual. If they had checked the O-rings, that's a simple probability problem. If they checked the O-rings, they would have known that they should not have sent that shuttle up that day. Okay? It would not have happened. NASA scientists should have studied their probability and statistics, and they didn't. But my question for you is this lowest duration time unusual? Not because we know what it was, but is the fact that it's a zero, does that kind of catch your eye and make you think something odd's going on?
Yes.
Okay, we want to figure out if that's unusual by a statistical rule. And the statistical rule is this. What was the mean duration of the flight times? You still have that. And what was the standard deviation? So if we want to find what are called the lower and the upper boundaries, this is how we do it.
This is how you get your box plot.
Not yet. We're not at box plot yet. Hang on. So for the lower boundary, I'm going to take 217.3 and I'm going to subtract the standard deviation
times
2. So 2 times 105.92. Is 211.84. All I did was multiply 2 times the standard deviation. So 2 times 2 is 4, 2 times 9 is 18, carry the 1 is 1, 2 times 5 is 10, 1 is 11, 2 times 1 is 2. So 211.84. And if I subtract these two, I got 5.66. Is that what you got? No? Okay, I'll buy that. I'm not using my calculator, so you guys are going to have to watch, okay?
You're going to have to teach.
Okay, this is the minimum, lowest, usual value. So is that zero unusual?
Yes.
Yes, because zero is less than 5.46. Now, is the highest value potentially
abnormal?
Well, the way we find that out is the same way, except we take 217.3 and we add 211.84.
For 11.
Four 29.14. Are any of those flight times more than 429.14?
No.
No. So this is the maximum or the highest usual value. So the zero is less than 5.46. So it is
unusual.
Okay. Does that mean we should have thrown that data value out?
No.
No. Now there might be a time when you are at least suspicious of one and you might want to recalculate like we did with the air conditioners because we had one that seemed kind of out of kilter with everybody else, but you don't just automatically throw it out because we know that value in particular actually happened. As a matter of fact, giving some more credit to the space program, there was an observational shuttle that was gathering data about weather phenomenon on another planet, and it was routinely throwing out the extremely high values that it found. Until the, well, it wasn't a planet, I think it was a star. Until the star it was observing exploded. And the explosion came as a complete surprise to everybody that was monitoring that data. They said, well, this shouldn't have happened because the mean was this and the standard deviation was this and that and that. And then they found out the program they wrote to collect the data automatically, routinely discarded the outliers. But the outliers really did happen. And those spikes in temperature was what created the explosion. Okay? So you don't always throw out something just because it seems unusual, but you do question why it's there. You do question why it's there and maybe exclude it from your calculations and then look at both sets of calculations. We're also going to talk about something called coefficient of variation.
Yeah.
This is useful if you're comparing data sets that don't have similar means. Suppose the mean price of bread is $2.19 with a standard deviation of 30 cents, and the mean price of this sedan is $17,900 with a standard deviation of $2,000. Which data set is less variable? Well, I can't really compare 30 cents to $2,000 because the mean in that one case is in dollars and cents, and the other one is in thousands of dollars, tens of thousands of dollars. So we can't compare the data sets because the means aren't close. But what we can do is we can do the coefficient of variation, which is actually pretty easy to calculate. The coefficient of variation is the standard deviation divided by the mean over 100. Yes. So it's the proportion of the standard deviation over the mean, and the times 100 simply changes it into a percentage. That's all the 100 does, is changes it to a percentage. The lower that coefficient of variation, then the less variability there is in the data. So what we're going to look at is we have the height and the weight of eight players from the Atlanta Braves. Their heights are 71, 75, 74, 72, 73, 73, 76, and 72. And their weights obviously are not anywhere close to any of those numbers. They're in the high hundreds and around 200 pounds. We want to compare, is there more variation in their height or more variation in their weight? And we can do that quickly with a calculator. So we're going to go into the data lists. I'm going to leave what's in list one, and I'm going to go to list two. And I'm going to enter the heights in list two. We're doing the weights in list three and the heights in list two. We're just not wiping out list one. You've got six lists, so you don't have to use any particular list. So you can just go right arrow right on over to list three and enter the weights. So once you've got both of your sets of data in list two and list three, we'll just practice a little bit here. We're going to calculate descriptive statistics. And the way we do is we go to stat, right arrow to calc, enter to choose one variable statistics, and then tell it the list that you want it to calculate with. So I'm going to start with list two. Keep talking if you still need help. Because I'm just going to record some stuff and give y'all a chance to catch up. Okay, now this is what I got, so y'all can compare. Go double check your data. I checked mine, but I can still look at my rule exception.
No,
that's a sample. Okay, well, see, what I was doing was recording before I actually did the division. So for the heights, here's my coefficient of variation. Yeah, we just do the arithmetic. Yeah, I just rounded. I didn't necessarily round properly because the coefficient's going to be close either way. So it's 2.278 or about 2.3%? Yes. So now the similar calculation for the weights would be two variable statistics, but I'll talk to you about that after class because I don't want to confuse anybody else. Now, I know you're looking for the lazy way out, and that's okay because I use it too. Okay, hang on. Let me get the values up here, and then I'll see if I can get people that are lost led back to the promised land. So the coefficient of variation is much larger for their height than for their weights. I mean, for their weights than it is for their heights. And it makes sense because their muscle mass is going to be different. Okay, who's having problems totally lost? Got it? Y'all are all in this together. So if somebody's close to you is lost and you can help them out, help them out.
It's less because look at your numbers. Your numbers are tightly combined compared to the 175 to 220.
Yeah, that's actually one way to look at it. Because remember, 11% is a lot more than 2.3%. But if you go back and look at these numbers,
look how many are closer together than.
These are very, very, very close together.
76 and 75.
Whereas these are really spread quite a bit more apart.
There's a greater variability.
There's a greater variability. Just intuitively looking at the numbers and thinking what variation means they're different from each other. Well, these are a lot more different from each other than these are. Okay? And the coefficient of variation is just a way to actually quantify that, actually put a number on it. Okay? Everybody good? I don't think we've got but one more thing to do. Don't make it hard.
So like on the test, are we going to have to know these formulas?
No, I give them to you.
Thank you.
I do not memorize formulas. People should have to memorize the phone book before formulas. It might be more useful. You might need to know the doctor's office number.
Cool.
19.
Let me look and see when our test is while everybody gets settled back down.
I'll say the day 23rd. So
how much do the weekend before? How much do the 18th? 7 days away. Are we going to come in here and do tests and go home? Or do we
We will have something else because this counts as two full class periods. But it will be something that you'll be able to do that won't be drudgery. I realize that your brain will be dead by then.
Bugs and Whiskers going to be on the test?
Yes. But your calculator does them. I'm going to show you how for the how to let the calculator do it.
Does it matter if you round or not?
Not really, because you're still going to come out with this. I mean, one's going to be bigger than the other as long as you round consistently. So it's okay if you round differently. Let's see. Chapter 3, 1, 2, and 3 quizzes are due on the 26th. So our test will be on the 27th.
Well,
we're finished with chapter 2. You've had time to work on that. Okay? The quizzes are the ones that are always the night before the test. Okay? So the test is on the 27th, 2 weeks from tonight. Yes, they're due the night before.
Are we allowed to do
no. No, but I will give you a practice test. I will give you a practice test that will be very, very close to the real thing, so you'll know exactly what I'm going to ask you. I'm not one of these people that believes you should hide what's going to be on the test. If you want your students to do well, you tell them what's on the test so they know what to study for. Yes, we will get a practice test. Okay. I'll probably give it to you pencil and paper, because the test will be pencil and paper. Most people do. Okay, so can we move on from this problem and finish our last thing?
Yes.
Absolutely. Will we go over that practice test?
You'll have the answers to it.
And all the homework is due by the 26th.
It's all due on the 26th. Okay, just comparing data sets, going back to the problem we looked at before, for the bread, the coefficient of variation was 13.7%, but for the car, it was only 11.2%. So the bread price varies a lot more from one place to another, from one loaf to another, than the price of that sedan does.
Hey.
And we're going to skip that one and talk about percentiles. How many of y'all ever took a standardized test? What does it mean if you scored in the 85th percentile?
That you're in the 85th percentile of everyone that took that test.
So if there were 100 people that took the test, the same, and you were one of that 100 people, what position among that 100 people would you occupy? The 85th person, okay? So the meaning of the percentile is just a location. Where do you stand relative to everybody else?
So if there's like 150 people, it would be different.
It would be different, yeah. But percentiles are normalizing it down to 100% of the population. That's why they call it percentile. It's just a position.
So you could be tied percentiles.
Yeah, you could be same. Let's look at the interpretation. I think that'll take care of what you're asking about. Suppose the weight of an infant child is in the 78th percentile. Now, there could be a lot of babies that have the exact same weight that that child does. They're all going to be at the 78th percentile. Okay? What that means is that the baby's weight is larger or heavier or greater than 78% of all the other babies. It does not mean that they weighed 78% of some kind of ideal weight. That is simply a measure of where they land in the population if they rank order the population. And we could also say that that infant's weight is less than 22
2% of all the babies because it's lighter than the top 22%. Okay? I'm not going to ask you to learn how to calculate percentiles. I want you to understand what they mean. Their meaning is much more important. They're just a location. Quartiles are a special kind of percentile because the quartiles that divide your data set up into four groups that have about 20%, 25% of the values in each one of the four groups. Okay? Now, those four groups may vary from each other as far as the individuals in that particular part of the group. Variation may be different in the lower quartile, the first 25%, from what it is in, let's say, between 50% and 75%. Those people may be more tightly clustered or more spread out. It only breaks the breaks them up into four groups with 25% of the data in each group. So your first quartile separates the bottom 25 from the top 75. Your second quartile is the median. It divides your population in half, upper 50% to the lower 50%. And then Q3 is your third quartile. It's at the 75th percentile mark. It divides the lower 75% from the upper 25%. Your calculator finds these for you. And those are important because they're a member of what we call the five-number summary, which lets us make a very, very special graph. The five-number summary is actually the three quartiles, Q1, Q2, and Q3, but Q2 is the median. And then the other two values are the lowest value and the highest value, the maximum and the minimum.
Why isn't there a fourth one?
The fourth quartile would be the 100th percentile.
So is that quartile 1 donated as Q1, denoted as Q1?
Mm-hmm.
And then 2?
Yeah.
Three.
Quartile 1 is Q1. Quartile 2 is Q2, and it's the same as the median. Mm-hmm. And quartile 3 is Q3. And then at the bottom of that page, or the next thing, you have something called the interquartile range. Inter means between, so that means between the quartiles. What is the range between the quartiles? And it is calculated using Q3 minus Q1. So there's 50% in your interquartile range because it's between your 25th percentile and your 75th percentile. Well, that's 50% of your data. There's 25% less than that, 25% more than that. Okay?
That's your box.
And one of the things that this is good for is it helps us find what we call outlier data values. We looked at maximum and minimum usual data values, but this is very similar to it. It's actually a much better way to find those. It picks out things that the other one won't. This is a box and whisker plot, or a box plot. So it uses the five-number summary by starting at the minimum value for the lower end of the first whisker and connect up the minimum value for the first quartile to get the lower whisker. Then the box is actually your interquartile range, and your median should be inside your box because it's your 50th percentile. It's going to be between 25th percentile and 75th percentile. And then your upper whisker connects up the third quartile to the maximum. So if you look at this box plot, this box plot is a set of data that is skewed because your maximum is very far away from the middle 50% of your data. Now here's a couple of other box plots, and we're going to use the data you've already got in your calculator to make a box plot. That's why I had you leave list one in there. So this box plot, it's not really skewed, it's nice and even. But this box plot, I don't know what this is, but most of the data values are between 205 and 638. And then we got this one outlier up here at 2840. And this is obviously an outlier because 75% of your data is down here.
It's only people on that ship.
Now, I'm going to show you this slide, but I'm going to show you how it actually works when we work with the data set that we're going to look at. We're going to use one we've already got in the calculator. And that formula is already on your handout. I'm not going to do example 9. I'm going to leave example 9 for you to do over the weekend. What I'm going to do, I want you to go back to the NASA space shuttle data. Hopefully you did not delete that data that was in list 1. Okay, if you did, just watch. Because you can do it with any data set that you want to. But I left that data set in there because I knew I was going to use it to show you box and whisker plots. In the first place, when I hit stat and calc and went to one var stats and asked it for list 1, it told me the mean, it told me the sum of the data values. Don't worry about what that thing right there means. That big ugly number has nothing to do with anything. It's part of a formula. It means nothing to you.
It means something to somebody else.
It means something to some programmer. This is the sample standard deviation. In case you were to have had a population, this is the population standard deviation. And we had 15 data values. But there's an arrow there. Do you know what that arrow means? It's pointing down. It means there's more stuff down there.
Uh-huh.
And it gives you your 5-number summary right off the top, okay? Stat and then enter. And it should still be there. Okay? So here's my 5-number summary. Now, if you want to take some notes, you can take these notes on the page that talks about modified box and whisker plots, because I'm going to show you how to make those. But I'm going to go to a clean sheet of paper. So I'm using the NASA data. And I've got the 5-number summary. So there's my 5-number summary. From this 5-number summary, I know that 50% of flights were between 165 and 262 hours. Okay? That's a good measure, a good interval to say, okay, this is where the typical flight is. It's somewhere between here and here, okay? But what's even better is to make a box plot. So you hit your second and your Y equals, and you choose plot 1. I'm going to write the steps down up here for you so they'll be in the recording. Press your second button, your Y equals button, and enter at that point to choose plot 1. Now I'm going to go back through the steps again. Second, Y equals, and then enter because we want to choose plot 1. second Y equals, and press enter to choose plot one. You're on a plot screen now. We're going to draw a graph. We're going to draw a graph on the calculator. Make sure that you press enter on the on key, on the on selection, arrow down, and then arrow across, because you can't just arrow down through those. You have to arrow across and go to the middle one on the second row. Arrow down and then across until you can get your cursor on the middle one on the second row. Okay, let me see, because the 84 is looking different. It's some of the newer ones looking different. Now, my data that I want it to use is in list one. Oop, messed up. So I select that one. My data is in fact in list one, but if that were not to have been there, I just press second and the number one key. And you leave that last number alone. Don't touch it. Don't mess with it.
And you might have a flashing something outside of X list. It'll say like L3. That'll
yeah, that's there. Just don't worry about it. Okay? Then from there, after you have turned it on, chosen the box plot, made your X list L1, leave your frequency at 1. This is your next keys. After you've got this turned on and set up, you press the zoom button in the middle of the top row. Go to number 9. Zoom stat. Press enter and there's your box plot. Okay. Now, you can trace on a box plot just like you can trace on a graph. There's your median. There's your third quartile. There's your maximum. There's your first quartile. There's your minimum that was zero.
When we get it, it got an error. What would cause that?
Let me look at what the error says, because it depends on what it says. There's no trace in it.
Yeah, if you get the arrows, I tell you you want to change that. And you're just going to pull them.
We're going to make one small change and we're done, and y'all don't have to do it. I'm just going to show you the difference. We said that the zero was an outlier in that data set, right? Okay, the zero was an outlier in that data set because it lies outside the fences, and I will explain this next week. But you can actually get a box plot that will show you the outlier. The only thing we're going to do differently is we're going to go down and instead of choosing the next to the last one, we're going to choose the fourth one, which if you notice is also a box plot. Okay? And then just hit graph again. And notice that it shortened that lower whisker, but there's a little dot down there below that line that's on here. So when I trace, my median didn't change, my first quartile didn't change, but that whisker stops at 73. And if I keep going down there to that outlier, there's that zero. It's not even part of the box plot. It's below the lower fence. It surpassed the boundary. So it's telling you that's an outlier. That's one data value that really is very different from the rest of your data set. Okay? So we are done for the night. Y'all take off, get some rest, and I'll see you next week. You too.